say, whoop, that is Hitman.
Show all you folks what it's all about. Now it's time for it to get on the mic and make this motherfucking party hype. I'm taking it back to the old school because I'm an old fool.
UNH Wildcat football moving in the right direction, straight to the top.
Proved to be one of UNH's most solid all-around campaigns in team history. Many team and individual statistics were dramatically higher than a year ago. On offense, the ground game with the loss of All-American Barry Barassa increased over 20 yards a game, averaging 173 for the season. 28.2, that's how many points UNH averaged a game. Couple that with an average of 415 total yards per contest, and you've equated one heck of a potent offense. Defensively, the Cats ranked tops in the Yankee Conference in the giveaway-takeaway ratio. Kudos to the secondary. Opponents had a tougher time traveling by air, as evidenced by the decline in yards passing per game, and running back slash quarterback sacks were way up, bringing big smiles to the UNH defensive coaches. And finally, for the oh, by the way file, UNH's attendance in Durham rose over 900 fans per game. The Cats were 4-1 at Cowell Stadium. Guess what, folks? The word is out. Realignment, the operative word in the Yankee Conference for the 93 season. Two divisions. The Mid-Atlantic, which housed teams such as Richmond and Delaware, and welcomed the additions of William and Mary, James Madison, and Northeastern. In the New England bracket, not hard to figure out, led by UMass, BU, and UNH. For the first time since its inception 43 years ago, the Division I-AA's premier conference took on an entirely new look.
You look at the Northern Division, you know, I think, you know, we should be, you know, we should be strong. I think UMass should be strong. I expect Connecticut to be, you know, a fairly strong team. I really think it's up for grabs, to be honest with you.
First stop, September 4th, Williamsburg, Virginia. The Cats taking on two of the new kids on the block, William and Mary. The tribe evolved into one of the conference's top squads in 93, and on this day, it showed. The team with two first names amassed 356 yards of total offense and capitalized on UNH's misfortunes to hand the Cats an opening day loss by a count of 27-14. Game 2, September 11th, Storrs, Connecticut, UNH versus UConn. Always a battle for both household pets, the Cats and the Huskies. Statistically, UNH manhandled these guys, 409 total yards to 292. But as you well know, statistics don't win football games, points do. This one went back and forth, deadlocked. at the end of regulation. The two teams went to sudden death. A missed extra point proved to be the difference as UConn held on to win 24-23. In desperate need of a pick-me-up, UNH used their 0-2 start to fuel a fire that would burn off three straight wins and see their record improve to 3-2.
Anytime you start a season off 0-2, it's kind of a downer, so to speak, but, you know, we're optimistic.
Their first victim, Richmond. Highly touted, highly respected, highly ineffective and unprepared. The Cats D gave up a season-low 49 yards rushing, while the offense stayed balanced enough to send the Spiders back to Richmond all in a knot. With a chance to even the record at 2-2, the University of New Hampshire welcomed the University of Maine to the friendly confines of Cowell Stadium, a Lions den. They treated them to a 63-13 demolition derby, 571 yards of total offense, including 338 through the air. Quarterback Jimmy Stayer picked up the New England Coca-Cola Gold Helmet for his efforts. Stayer and David Gamble made it painfully obvious to the Maine sidelines this was their day to shine. The Cats got their third win in a row on the road and didn't even have to leave the Granite State to get it. UNH traveled north to face the second-best football squad in the state, Dartmouth. Upon leaving beautiful Hanover, UNH had escaped with a penalty-filled 14-7 triumph and increased their record to 3-2 on the year. All good things must come to an end. It's a cliche heard far too many times in the sports arena, but it fits so perfectly with UNH's October 16th visit to Harrisonburg, Virginia, to take on James Madison. UNH began the game immediately behind the eight ball, falling behind very early. The Duke's offense, it resembled a Rolls-Royce, fine-tuned and moving along ever so smoothly. 550 yards of total offense. UNH's 382 wasn't bad. It just came much too late in the game for it to matter. Final score, James Madison 45, UNH 21. Week 7, UNH had already played to a 2-0 record at home, so what better place to spend the next fortnight? October 23rd, Northeastern entered Durham city limits as UNH's homecoming opponent. The Cats' dominance of Barry Gallup's squad continued, as UNH has now not lost to Northeastern since 1972. 21-6 your final on this day. The offense failed to tip the scales, racking up 205 yards rushing and an identical 205 yards passing. Week 8, October 30th, the game everyone was waiting for. UNH versus the undefeated Boston University Terriers, led by the Doug Flutie of the 90s, quarterback Robert Daugherty.
I think we're ready for the challenge, and you know, they're one of the top offenses in the country, and defensive secondary is going to have to step up big, and looking forward to the challenge.
All season long, Daugherty made a habit of making defenses look foolish. Not this weekend, Robbie. UNH gave BU one of their toughest tests all year, and it wasn't until late in the second half the Terriers were able to finally pull ahead for good. 24-14, the final. Now 4-4 on the year, the Cats travel to Villanova, Pennsylvania to trounce their fellow conference Wildcats. The first play from scrimmage, Rich Green goes 80 yards off tackle for a beautiful touchdown. UNH is ecstatic, Villanova dumbfounded. The Cats from the north go on to annihilate Andy Talley's squad, 45-14. David Gamble proves why he is the real deal, a gold helmet performance. The following weekend against Rhode Island, Gamble got better, and the rest of the team followed suit. Number 6 played like an Armani, while the URI defense resembled a light blue polyester special with plenty of holes in it.
Completes the pass over the middle to David Gamble, gets a block, and David Gamble's in a foot race at the 50, the 40, the 35, the 30, the 20. They're not going to catch him. High stepping into the end zone for his third touchdown of the afternoon. Number 6, David Gamble.
Final weekend of the year, UNH having already locked up another winning season, Coach Bose's 19th. It was off to Amherst to tackle UMass. The Minutemen jumped out to a 15-0 halftime lead, but UNH showed the resilience they had all season, mounting yet another comeback, only to fall a bit short, 15-13, the final on that final Saturday of the season. The Cats finished the campaign at 6-5. Another winning season for the UNH Wildcats. And the players deserve a handful of the credit, but so do the people that teach and care for the players. UNH once again has assembled the finest coaching staff in Division I AA football, and it begins at the top with the country's Dean of Division I AA coaches. Bill Bowes will enter his 23rd season at the helm of the Wildcat program. Already having won 142 games, there may be no one better at motivating, educating, and preparing his players for football life and life after football.
It was a great 5 years here. I wouldn't change it for the world. And this is a hard-working program that is always in the top of the Yankee Conference. And I'm glad I was part of it.
I'm very happy the way I ended my senior year. But it's gonna hurt. But I'm really gonna miss UNH. But I feel that I gave 100% effort when I came in, and I left with 100% effort.
Right here, right now.
You can count on a great education from the University of New Hampshire, and you can also count on Nancy Brown making sure your academic goals are met. It's difficult for college athletes to manage their time while on their own. Nancy makes the transition a whole lot easier.
It's about being somewhat of a family here in the UNH football program, and having someone like Nancy who really perpetuates that philosophy. As they say, it's very difficult to put into words how important she is.
What a school. UNH offers so much. Written word doesn't do it the justice it deserves. 12,500 enrolled students, 649 full-time faculty members nestled in this quaint New England town of Durham. If you enjoy city life, Boston, just 45 minutes south. If you enjoy country life, the White Mountains are just 2 hours to the north, ski country as we like to call it. And if you enjoy great college life with a strong commitment to athletics, look no further than Durham, 03824. Boy, the Fox Network, they've got their hands in everything. And speaking of networks, WMUR-TV, the New Hampshire ABC affiliate, is proud to bring UNH football live to well over 100,000 households each home weekend. No other Yankee Conference school can offer the opportunity of network affiliate TV coverage and weekly college coaches show appearances.
There's no school in the country that gets into it any more than you guys do here at the University of New Hampshire.
Some of this came year's best guests were the seniors, much in part to their on-the-field heroics. Boy, we see some great individual performances by the team's upper-class leaders.
I wanna shoot, baby, shoot.
We start off with defensive end Chad Ames. Chad ends his four-year stay at UNH as not only a fine football player, but a class act. Ames is one of the school's brightest students. Chad will take his 17 tackles on the year and his education to move on to much bigger and better things. Chad, we wish you the best of luck. Wide receiver Joe Capaldo ends his UNH career just as he started it, as one of the hardest working members of the team. Well respected for his work ethic, Joe appeared in two games this season, highlighted by his first collegiate reception versus the University of Rhode Island in the last 2 weeks of the season. Never overlooked and never underappreciated, special team standout Brian Cotter. He'll be missed more than UNH would like to imagine. Brian possessed immense leg strength, allowing opponents to rarely return his deeply booted kickoffs. As far as special teams is concerned, Brian Cotter wins the MVP award for the 93 campaign as the top special team performer for UNH. Brian's short-range partner Lance Yelty finished the year third on the team in scoring, splitting the uprights on 38 of 41 point after touchdowns and converting on 4 of 6 field goal attempts on the year. Lance's highlight of the season came in the 63-13 win over UMaine when Lance set a school record for booting 9 consecutive extra points in one game. Defensively, Coach Jack McNeil Jr. loses a couple of anchors. Defensive tackle Matt McBride and nose guard Doug Melson will both answer the graduation call in the spring. McBride saw time in one game this season, registering 2 tackles. Doug appeared in 6 games, collecting 3 stops. The offensive line loses one man and a darn good one, Little Silver, New Jersey native Todd Roth. At 6'2", 270 pounds, this fella leaves quite a big gap in Phil Estes' line. Ross saw plenty of time the past season and did a great job of opening huge holes for Abram and Lee and did a super job of protecting Rich and Jimmy. Another offensive standout that will be sorely missed, backup fullback Mark Newport. Buff, as they like to call him, had a super senior year. He rushed for 39 yards on 12 carries and hauled in 2 catches for 13 yards. Mark appeared in all 11 games in 93. Now, much to Mark's credit, coaches were quoted as saying Mark is one of the finest football players and finest students to ever walk the streets in Durham.
Now it's time to break it.
Come on, come on. Come on, come on.
Eric Kutz gets our award for the biggest punter in the Yankee Conference's history. 6 foot, 225 pounds, neck rolling off, the linebacker slash punter did both jobs effectively. Kutz banged out 56 punts for the year and came up with a beauty of an interception versus Richmond earlier in the season. But where you find Eric not far behind, you'll find Shemani, linebacker Steve Shemani. Just a great senior campaign for number 97. 26 tackles, 16 of them primary. Stevie started 6 of the 11 games scheduled and covered 2 fumbles to boot. Kutz and Shemani personify the dictionary term for teammates and friends. On to the quarterback, number 19, Rich Green. He was down, but far from out. Green spent the first 6 games watching from the sidelines. Then he got his chance to get on the field and turn it up.
Green fakes, going for the corner for David Gamble. Touchdown, New Hampshire. Gamble ties Braun's record, his 10th touchdown reception of the season.
Richie finished the year 92 for 173, good for over 1,500 yards and 11 touchdowns. His rating, an impressive 139.68.
Hitman.
Everybody's favorite target, the showman, the chairman of the board, king of the hill, primetime. This guy makes Deion Sanders look timid. Number 6, David Gamble. Nobody has ever had a season quite as exciting as Gamble. 67 receptions, too short of a record. 1,138 yards receiving, a new UNH record. He averaged 16.9 yards per catch, and he scored 13 touchdowns through the air, a new record for UNH. He also added a 57-yard rushing TD on a beautiful reverse. Give Gamble 14 total on the year. Very impressive.
Wait, okay. I mean, he looks in the camera.
You gotta look good, dude.
You ready? Games are won by playing good, sound defense and creating turnovers. Bobby Jordan did it better than anyone. Opposing quarterbacks dreaded throwing anywhere near number 33 because it usually ended up in his hands. 8 interceptions this season and 35 tackles. Great man-to-man cover defensive back. His strength, his athleticism, huge assets. He will be sorely missed. They've got some big, big shoes to fill on that corner. The defense loses another mainstay, their captain, number 9, the human pile driver, Mike Cassano. No one in the conference hit harder than this 5'10" stick of dynamite. The captain exploded on the season, finishing 2nd on the team in tackles with 74, 41 of which were primary. Paisan also tossed in 4.5 running back sacks, 3 pass breakups, and a pick, not to mention a ton of big hits. Let me say yeah! The offense loses the best 1-2 receiving punch in the conference. Gamble may have provided the knockout punch on many occasions, but Mike Craney set up the fatal blow with his steady jabs and toughness. Number 5 did everything. Block, catch, run, and lead. Lead by example. 40 receptions covering 587 yards and 1 touchdown. You didn't need to know Mike for long to know he would be a great teammate, a real hard worker, and a super nice guy. A few characteristics shared by all the seniors from the 1993 season. As we come to a close, in the future, remember, you're one of the luckiest people in the world to have been able to attend a great college and perform at the collegiate level. You've made friendships that will last a lifetime. For most, this whole story is a far-fetched fantasy. For you, it was a reality. Be proud of yourself, guys. You've worked hard. Good luck, everybody. We'll see you in the years ahead.